preaching for us a little bit later. And but before we do that, we're going to sing another song, and the song is King of Kings.
Thank you. The scripture reading this morning is taken from James chapter 1, verses 19 and 20. My dear brothers and sisters, take note of this. Everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry, because human anger does not produce the righteousness that God desires. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading of his word this morning.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Lovely to see most of church back. And of course, we think of those who are unwell and those who are still away. But mostly those who are unwell. And good morning, online family. Hi, Lily. Well, I wonder how many of us this morning have noticed lately, be it social media or in person, people are easily offended of late, much more than they ever used to be. Easily offended. So today we start our new sermon series called No Offense. So if anyone has started a sentence or ended a conversation with you by saying blah, 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 no offense, they know they were offensive, or they wouldn't have to put a hashtag on it. No offense. People in our culture are easily offended and easily angered, and I'm sure it's not just us. I'm sure it's everywhere. And what is our response as a follower to Jesus and all the things that Jesus represents? How, as followers of Jesus, do we deal with the anger and the hatred that is so everywhere in the world today? Hatred and anger have always been everywhere, but now it just seems to be more everywhere, deeper, more concentrated, more readily available. I truly believe that we can choose to be offended or not offended. Just like you can choose to be happy, you can make a decision to have a good time wherever you're at, whatever you're doing. You can choose to take offense or not take offense. It's entirely up to you. And if you're sitting there saying, it's easy for you to say, Debbie, that's fine, I'm not offended. I can guarantee you, though, it's not easy for me to say. I'm a human, but the amount of work over the last nearly two decades of my life that I have put into moving past those things that would offend me and being better than my original state, I can say I know the difference of being offended and choosing not to be. And most of the time when I am offended, I choose not to be. And I've gone to a place in my mind where I say, they can be right if they want to be. I know they're wrong, and when they are proven wrong, I'll just have a little party in my head because it's not worth coming out of my mouth, but I can still be right and not hurt another. I can still be right and let them think they're right because it's up to them. It's got nothing to do with me. And I don't need to be offended. You can be unoffendable. That is not a word, but we're going to use that today. And I know it's not a word because the red line kept coming up on the computer every time I typed it. It's not a word. But you can become unoffendable. You have the armor of God. Use it. Put it on. Become the superhero with the power of unoffendability. You can choose it. You can tell yourself that I'm wrong, and that's okay. You might even be thinking that I don't know the crazy people that you have to deal with every day. That's true, I don't. These people that you deal with, they go on and on. They are relentless, are they not? They're critical, they're loud, they're opinionated. And maybe you feel criticized often. That may be true of those around you, but it doesn't have to be true of you. You make choices for you, which best help you. You can choose not to be offended. You can become unoffendable. God started to search my heart many years ago, and He has done a work in me of real healing when it comes to being offended or not being offended, speaking or not speaking. Sometimes you don't have to talk, and there are people who don't realize that's an option. You don't have to talk, you don't have to say anything. It's not a must. Just because somebody has said something to you, you don't have to speak in response. You don't have to do anything. And that is what the power of the Holy Spirit showed me. Where once I was easily offended and quick to defend myself or those around me, friends and family. During this journey, you may end up offended over the course of the series. But I encourage you to take that and use it and turn it so that you are empowered to be unoffendable. This is an achievable goal, I assure you. It might not happen over 4 weeks, but it is a starting point. We're looking at James this morning. James, the brother of Jesus. And as Wes read to us, my dear brothers and sisters, take note. Everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry. Now ask yourself, how are you going with this? When I was young, and you've probably heard it too, we are asked to listen twice as much as we speak. That's why we have two ears and one mouth. Yeah. It's a good one. It borderlines a dad joke, so it's iffy. Are you working within the framework of this verse? Or are you struggling or getting the order mixed up? Are you a person who gets angry straight out of the gate without any thought, without brain in gear? And then you spend the next year trying to make amends. It is a biblical teaching that we get this order right. Quick to listen. Slow to speak. Slow to become angry. So throughout the sermon, take a moment to just do a quick audit. Am I quick to listen? Am I slow to get angry? Just check in with yourself. Don't condemn yourself if you come up, oh, actually, I'm really quick to get angry. There's no condemnation required. There's no punishment to be doled out. We're moving forward. I believe we are living in a time and culture where people are not quick to listen. People want their own opinions heard and respected, yet are not mature enough or gracious enough to listen to what others want to say as well. Jesus was and is our example of these disciplines in action. He was slow to speak. He was careful. He thought out what he was going to say, and he was respectful. He listened to people, and he made time for their thoughts without disrespecting them, speaking over them, or becoming angry with them if their opinions differed from his. Maybe you've never looked at this, but how many questions do you think Jesus was asked that have been recorded in Scripture? Anyone want to have a stab? No one, especially not John. John doesn't want to have a stab. 183 times the Scripture records somebody asked Jesus a question. I'm sure it was probably more, but recorded in the Scripture 183 times. Now, have a guess. How many times do you think Jesus gave a direct hit answer? Three times. And I can see on your faces like, that doesn't seem right. Three times Jesus answered with a direct answer. And he's probably the reason we have the expression, you should never answer a question with a question. However, in Jesus' case, he has recorded 307 questions that he asked other people. Because he is incredibly focused on the other person. He was slow to speak, and he was quick to listen. So when he was asked something, he asked something in return. He asked them about them. He was interested in what was happening for the other person, not so much what was happening for him. When we think about being slow to become angry, perhaps you can reflect on times when this wasn't a habit for you, to be slow to become angry. Maybe it's currently not a habit you're in. Perhaps you're too quick to anger. If so, now is the time to revisit that. Perhaps some tweaking is in order. Perhaps you've never thought about how quick you are to become angry before, or annoyed, irritated. Anger in its place and for normal and properly deserved reasons can bring about a positive outcome. Anger which is unbridled and escalating can bring about great destruction. And you don't need to look hard to find great destruction in our world. People are angry. People are distressed and don't know how to deal with it. If you get enough people who are angry about the same thing, they feed each other's anger. And it gets bigger. It grows like a wildfire. It becomes out of control. And each person's misplaced sense of superiority becomes their support group for another person who feels the same anger about the same position. No one in that group has got any clear thinking. It just keeps growing, it keeps getting worse, and we have a catastrophe. I don't think being easily angered is pleasing to God. Scripture tells us it isn't. Now is time for the hard question. If you've sought your spirit while we've been in the sermon, while I've talked, you should be able to ask yourself, how effective is my anger? When I'm angry about something, how effective is it? How am I using it? Am I just lashing out? Or am I actually thinking through, why am I angry? How has this affected me? How has this hurt me? How am I going to move forward from this position? Is it working for me and the people around me? Is it making me more like Jesus? Is my life pointing others to the intimacy of life and the joy and freedom found in Christ? Anger rarely leads people to that. How effective is your anger? Is it making you more loving? Is your anger making you more peaceful? Spoiler alert, it isn't. It's a negative. It's not working according to the scripture. So why doesn't it benefit the human? Why doesn't anger benefit the human? We've seen world wars come about because someone couldn't have their own way. Anger escalated into catastrophe. It does not benefit the human soul, and it spills out on others. Because the human anger does not produce the righteousness that God desires. Second part of our verse this morning. In the throes of our anger, we can try to justify it away by saying, I've got righteous anger. I'm allowed to do this. I'm defending God. I'm righteously angry. Unfortunately, no. As a human being, we don't actually have any claim on righteous anger. I've heard it all my life. Righteous anger. I'm allowed to do this. I'm a Christian. I'm allowed to have righteous anger. You're not allowed to have righteous anger. The scripture says that he who is without sin shall cast the first stone. Sadly, none of us can cast the first stone. So if you have a stone, put it down. We cannot cast the first stone. We could probably make a self-righteous claim to anger, but I'm yet to meet one person in my world who wants to be known as self-righteous. We don't want that either. I don't want to be known as self-righteous. So go ahead and ask yourself again, how effective is my anger? We need to make a decision. We need to decide, what are we going to do when we do get angry? Are we going to make a point, or do we want to make a difference? Most people in the Salvation Army are here because we're trying to make a difference. We're trying to help. We're trying to build up. We're trying to move past those things in the world that bring other people down. We want to make a difference. We don't want to make a point. Too many people are already out there making their point. It's monotonous. It's boring now. Well, for me, it was boring in the first place. But I am tired of it. I want to be so bold as to suggest that we need a different attitude and a different philosophy when dealing with the wrongs of the world. Becoming angry ourselves about the things of the world that are unjust, unloving, unpeaceful. We need a better attitude. We need a way forward that's not thrusting our anger out into the world, because people are already doing that. Rather than allowing our feelings to direct our actions, we need to let the Spirit of God direct our actions, so that we aren't making a point. We're making a difference. Points come and go. Differences remain. We're not just trying to win an argument. We should never be trying to win an argument. We're trying to win people with the grace of God. That is what we are trying to do. You're still with me? It's really hard behind masks. I hate the masks. Hate it. But the eye contact is good. Back to scripture. There is a guy in scripture, smart guy. He is an expert in the law. This guy knows everything, so he thinks. He is intelligent, he is educated, and he works in the law. So he says to Jesus, what is the most important thing? People are always trying to trap Jesus all the time. What is the most important thing? This is one of the few questions Jesus answered directly. And he said, the most important thing is to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. And some translations say, in all your strength. That is the most important thing. And it was a direct answer. He didn't ask a question. He said directly, this is the most important thing. If we think about this instruction, it goes to show you we can't possibly be angry if every component of your being is focused on God. It's impossible to show anger if you are consistently showing grace and love to people. I'm not standing here saying you'll never be irritated and annoyed and get cross. But when those feelings come upon you, refocus and do what you can do to let the Spirit move you towards the grace and love for people. Jesus never commanded us to be right. That is not in the Ten Commandments. And number 10, you should always be right. That's not it. That's not there. We don't have to stick to our guns because we think we're right, to the point where we alienate everyone around us and no one is interested in Jesus. What he did say was, I want you to be loving. Love, 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 love. Not with hearts and chocolates, but I will take chocolates and songs and silly rot. Actual deep love and concern for another human being. We've grown up in a culture that tells us the only way to make change is to be angry, to scream blue murder, to make a scene, and to be heard by the masses. It is in our calm that things stay controlled. It is in our anger that results are ineffective. I've heard more than my share of people being angry with the government. I will not allow people to talk to me about that anymore because I am tired of it. If you want to rubbish the government, I'm not your girl. because it doesn't help. It's not helpful. It's the reverse of that. It's ineffective. Being angry about things that you cannot change is ineffective, and it's not Christ-like, and it is not worthy of you. You are better than that. And Christ knows you are better than that. And other things. I just used that because it was there. The best soldiers in war aren't angry in battle. They are trained. They do what they're trained to do. They don't go in hot-headed and angry. So a disciple or follower of Jesus knows how to fight the battle. We go in with love. We don't go in with anger. We face the forces of the darkness every day. We are not without our temptations just because we follow Christ. We are there. We understand the plight of the human. So why be angry with them? Why be angry with another human who is struggling along the same path you're struggling on? We lead with love, not anger. Hearts are rarely changed by an angry response. They are, however, changed by compassion, love, and empathy. I never truly share my strong opinions on topics, especially topics which I know are going to cause an unnecessary argument. There are goings on and topics which I feel very strongly about, and I will never speak them, because my desire for a relationship with people far outweighs my desire to be right, or my desire to cause an unnecessary fight, or my desire to hurt another person. And I don't need them to come outside of my mouth or outside of my head for me to know how I feel about it. Others don't need to know how I feel about a thing. And my life still goes on happily. I journey in peace. I choose not to be offensive most of the time, and I choose not to be offended. If your opinion differs from mine, why shouldn't it? We're not the same person. I will not hold your opinion against you just because it isn't the same as mine. I will not run the risk of losing a friendship over a difference of opinion. It doesn't make any sense to me. So I choose to keep my extremely strong opinions close to my own heart, and there they stay, not causing any problems for me or others. So how do we let go of the kind of anger that makes us feel like we might be going mad? Firstly, lower your expectations of people. No one can live up here. No one can. And it's really important that we don't try to make people feel as though they've got to live up to our expectations. Because if you lower your expectations of people, you will find you've lowered your expectation of yourself and things will run much smoother. I'm not saying look down on people. Please don't hear that I'm saying that, because I'm not. I'm saying have a reality check and give people and yourself a break. It's not easy life right now. I remember a life before COVID where it was a bit easier, a bit simpler. Now it's so complicated, let's give each other a break. Let's drag away everything that we think we knew. Let's start again by lowering what we think other people should be capable or able to do for us, or with us, or around us. And just breathe out and let everybody off the hook. I'm the first person to know the disappointment of being let down, and I'm sure we all know the disappointment of being let down by another person. I've been hurt and I've been angry, and I say, give both of us a break. We never truly know what goes on for another person. We don't know why they've let us down, and they probably never tell us. And if you get caught up in the cycle of, why didn't they do this? Why aren't they talking to me? Blah, 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 blah. Then you're raising your expectation of what that person should have been able to do for you. And you're just hurting yourself. I've also been the guilty party of letting somebody else down. Because I'm human And this is what happens from time to time. If we don't do this, our anger will continue to fester and our joy will be snuffed out. The Word of God says that people will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boastful, proud, abusive, disobedient, ungrateful, unholy, without love, unforgiving, slanderous, without self-control, brutal, not lovers of good, treacherous, rash, conceited, lovers of pleasure, rather than lovers of God. This is just a sum up of the people in our world. So I'm not really sure why anyone would be surprised if somebody doesn't call them back. Oh, it's been 2 seconds, they haven't texted me. Oh, they must hate me. Oh, what did I ever do to them? I'm not speaking to them anymore. That was really quick, but that's what happens. So they might be in the shower when you text. They might be at work. Their phone is flat. There's so many reasons why somebody hasn't messaged you back or rung you back or something. And while you have this great expectation that that person is constantly ready on the phone waiting for your call, that's too high. Give people a break. Give yourself a chance to relax. And approach that person always with love. Because people will let you down. It's normal. The hideous truth is, we will also let people down. Also normal. People are not perfect. And we should never expect them to be. We should never try to be. I've often felt like I must be wired wrong, or I've been desensitized somewhere. Because I had thought that that was the case for me until I wrote this sermon. I am not scandalized by any human behavior. And I haven't been for a really long, long time. And it could be that as an officer, I see a lot of strange human behaviors. But even at the beginning of my ministry, I wasn't really shocked by stories I was told, things that I've seen. It's human behavior. What can you do except love them and show them a safe space to land? If you're scandalized by everything that you hear, I encourage you to relax and say to yourself, this is human behavior and I need to show that behavior love. Jesus didn't roam around looking for scandal so that he could shine a spotlight on it and humiliate the person. That's our job, apparently. He wasn't angry every time he met a person that didn't agree with him. He went on loving them, just as each one of us is called to do. If anyone had the right to be scandalized, it was Jesus. And the human responsible for that was Peter. Peter, oh, such a man. Peter lied, he betrayed Jesus, he denied him. He stabbed him in the back and he abandoned him. Now, had this happened to us, we would unfriend them immediately and avoid them at all costs because of these horrible things that they've just done to us. Peter, his behavior was not surprising to Jesus at all. He forgave him, he loved him, gave him a new assignment and sent him to care for the sheep. Of course, Peter didn't understand that at the time, but we do now. He gave him another shot to go out and love the people, serve the people, care for the people. That's our assignment. The next thing, I think, and the last thing for today, number two, to help with our anger, we need to raise our gratitude of God's grace. Sometimes I think we forget the enormity of being given the grace of God. It's not like, here's your Christmas present, I hope you like it. It is the most amazing gift you have ever been given, and I don't think we embrace it well enough. Ephesians says, "For it is by grace that you have been saved through faith, and it is not from yourselves. There is nothing you can do, not a thing, to save you from yourself. That is why we need grace. The pain of this life is inevitable and comes to all of us in one form or another. We're going to be in a painful situation at some point. And if you've lived this long and haven't, amazing, and bless you, and I am so happy for you. But I'm going to go out on a limb and say no. We've all managed a painful situation at some point in our lives. Some of it we don't understand. Some of it we cling to instead of handing it over. I'm a clinger. I tend to cling until it clicks. Light bulb goes on, like, oh, sorry, yeah. And that's why I'm in so much pain. I don't hand it over. Raising our gratitude can help us face the ugly moments that vary slightly from person to person. They're uncomfortable, and then some of them are earth-shattering for us. But look at us, still standing. The human will to survive is extremely strong, and we move forward. When we become angry over a situation that has hurt and disappointed us, we have a very real human reaction. God does not accuse us for our human reaction. Even if it ends in disaster, he still doesn't accuse us. But we can forget to be grateful for the grace that he's poured out. And our faith takes a knock. So finally, before we finish, I wanted to look at the story of the couple caught in adultery and those angry men standing ready to stone this woman. She had done wrong and she would be punished. And there's Jesus. Not angry, not disappointed, not ready to cast her aside, but he calmly pointed out that she wasn't the only person in the circle who had sinned. And then we have the passage I said earlier, let he who is without sin cast the first stone. And if you know the story, you'll know that one by one, they dropped their stones and walked away. When the world is out of kilter and an injustice has taken place, we feel angry. We should feel angry. We have anger as an emotion because you're supposed to do something positive with it. When a child is hurt, we feel angry because children are to be protected and loved and nurtured, not hurt. When an old person is physically beaten by somebody breaking into their house, we get angry. That's an injustice. That's not right. Something has to be done. It does. Something has to be done. But we're not called to be vigilantes. We are called to love. Really angry people have a hard time making a difference. If we deal with enough anger, at some point, Jesus is going to say, lower your expectations of yourself. There isn't anything that you can do here. This is my fight. But raise your gratitude for the grace you've been given and work in that. Because Jesus didn't call us to be right. He called us to be loving. Our goal is not to make a point, but to make a difference. Jesus, quick to listen, slow to speak, slow to become angry. Our human anger does not produce the righteousness that God desires. So let's lead with love. Nothing's stopping us. Let's lead with love. Let's stop making a point. It's not working. I'm going to invite the team to come. And as they play this morning, they're going to play Lift Up Your Eyes. And I pray that you will seek out his guidance on this, that you will do an audit of your spiritual well-being. do you need to lower your expectations of yourself and the expectations you have for other people? Do you need to raise your gratitude for the grace you've been given? I believe a new sense of peace will come over you if this is where you're at. As we sing, I encourage you to embrace whatever the Spirit is telling you this morning. Let's sing.
God, we come before you and we want to be the best reflection of you that we can be. Thank you, God, for the message this morning that challenges us to choose to love even when it hurts. Lord, continue to use us to be a beacon of hope and light and grace and mercy in this community, we pray. And we pray these things in your name. Amen. The announcements for this morning are that kids' church has recommenced today. How good? So they're out there loving themselves and loving everything about it. Nobody's more excited about it than some of the mums in the room. Ew! First aid training is next weekend. So if you're wanting to get your first aid certificate or recertify your CPR, then that can happen next Saturday. There's a discount for anybody that is wants to wear a Broncos jersey. No, there's not. But Bill, who's the guy that's coming out to run it, was the chaplain at the Broncos for 20 years. So that would be very funny, actually, if everyone did. But I don't think there'd be some people that would not come at all if they had to wear a Broncos jersey, Debbie. Anyway, first aid training's on next week, 9:30, and that's in the back hall. There's quite a number coming and a whole bunch from community, so lots of connections there, which is fantastic. Kids in the Kitchen starts back on Wednesday. So if you're wondering what you're having for dinner this week, those leaders that are in a part of it, wonder no more. It's bacon and eggs. It's mac and cheese. Mac and cheese, yeah. Get keen. Also a change of day this year for his master builders. It's on Tuesdays this year. So Tuesday afternoon at 3:30, Lego Club here at the hall. So,
sorry, I forgot to update that. It's straight after school. So whatever time that is.
Look, it's at 3:30, but we'll say straight after school in real life. 3:30 on the screen because I can't change that now.
Yeah, sorry, that's
So anyway, come along and have some fun with the leaders that do that. That's all the announcements that I have for this week, other than to congratulate one person on finding out what their grandbaby was this week. I'm not going to name names or tell you what it is, but you can go and ask Kathy at morning tea. She knows all about it, and she knows all about... no, you don't get to come out here. It says Wes. But it's not triplets, no. Or she would be fully grey right now. But go and ask her at morning tea. Celebrate with her. We're looking forward to her becoming a grandma, maybe? What's your name going to be, Kathy? Grandma. There we go. You heard it here first. Debbie's got an announcement. She's pushing in.
This is an announcement for those who do have children in kids' church, whether you are the parent, auntie, uncle, whatever you are. The requirements are now that they get signed in and signed out. So at the end of church, unfortunately, you'll have to take any conversation that you're having over there and grab your kids, because once they're signed out, they're signed out. And we need the kids' church members to be allowed to go off and have their morning tea as well. So grab your kid as soon as you can after church is finished and sign them in, sign them out, so we have a record of their safety. Okay. And that's it from me, and the band are going to play, and I'm going to do this. All right. Well, apparently. Let's be upstanding and let's sing Teach Me to Dance. Is there an intro, please, Doug? Yes, okay. No, there's not. There's not. Straight in.
To dance to the beat of your heart, teach me to move in the power of your spirit, teach me to walk in the light of your presence, teach me to dance to the beat of your heart, teach me to love with your heart of compassion, teach me to trust. Teach me to dance to the beat of your heart.
addiction. I pray that you will feel truly blessed this week, that you will seek God's face in all your encounters, and that you would be a blessing to others. In Jesus' name, amen.